This is SURGUCATION, surgical education for parents. We are here to inform, inspire, connect, and heal.
Pectus Excavatum, SURGUCATION Episode 9. Dr. Timothy Kane, Chief of General and Thoracic Surgery, Children's National Hospital. Hi, welcome to another episode of SURGUCATION. I'm your host, Dr. Mikael Petrosyan. Today we have Dr. Timothy Kane as our guest, and we're going to discuss a diagnosis called pectus excavatum, which all it means is concave chest. We do see a lot of patients, normally teenagers, and we do often see also young kids, but Tim and I do these procedures here at Children's National Hospital, and we wanted to talk about it a little bit and answer some questions that some parents may have. Welcome to SURGUCATION, Tim.
Thank you.
All right. Why don't you tell our listeners what is pectus excavatum?
So, yeah, thank you for having me. So, pectus excavatum is the most common chest wall asymmetry, and it's where the chest wall is caved in a concave fashion. It's also called funnel chest, and it affects 1 in 300 to 400 kids, mostly boys, 3 times more likely in males than females. It's something where it could appear at birth, but most commonly it appears in adolescence and associated with rapid growth spurts where, you know, 1 year the chest may look normal, but an adolescent goes through a growth spurt and the next year he has a big hole or caved in chest. So it's something that pediatricians will frequently see, and the time for referral is really when it's first noticed, and then we could answer questions related to that.
Is this hereditary?
Right. There's no specific genetic link, but it's very common to be associated in families, parents and children, brothers, sisters, brothers, can all have it. So although there's not a genetic link, it's very common to be found in families.
Some would argue that this is somewhat cosmetic operation. Do you agree with that?
I don't. There's data in the adult literature and pediatric literature which shows that there's a improvement of the end-diastolic filling volume of the heart, cardiac MRI, and intraoperative right ventricular, left ventricular strain with release or improvement of the correction of the pectus excavatum. So we probably haven't done the correct studies yet to prove that objectively, but subjectively, in patients who are athletes before and after, almost 100% will say they have improved stamina and function. We're just working on trying to prove that in studies, but there's definitely a dynamic compression of the heart prior to pectus repair if it's severe, and improvement after. And some kids don't notice that they have decreased exercise tolerance because this has been there for a little bit of time and they haven't really thought about it. But when they have surgery afterwards, majority of our patients will say they feel better stamina.
Correct. So there are a few tests that we normally get when parents come to us and with kids who have pectus excavatum. These are three tests, and three tests are CAT scan.
Mm-hmm. CAT scan basically is the single test you need just to document the severity of the chest wall asymmetry or the pectus. There are kids who, if it looks like a mild asymmetry, we don't order studies initially, or we'll wait till they get older. Because there's no need to get a study unless the family or child is interested in having a procedure, or if the practitioner thinks it's severe enough to warrant surgery. The other test to get is an echocardiogram, because there's often some cardiac anomalies associated with 5 or so percent of pectus excavatum can be associated with a cardiac condition, right. Which sometime down the road may need some repair, like aortic root dilation or anomalous coronary arteries. And in terms of a screening tool, our purpose of getting the cardiac echo is not to see if the pectus is causing anything, but to rule out other sources, which
correct.
One day they may need a sternotomy to have that repaired. The other test that is not always done but frequently is the pulmonary function test, and those probably have the lowest yield in terms of determining what to do surgically, because most of them don't show any abnormalities. Young, healthy teenagers, it takes a lot for them to have decreased lung function based on their chest wall, but some insurance companies request that. I would say we get pulmonary function tests in less than 10% of our patients.
Yeah, I agree. And then the other test that we normally get is allergy testing, which is important. It's became a standard of care recently to get the allergy testing because it tests for a number of metals that are detected in the actual pectus bar. So there's two kinds of bars. There is titanium bar and there is a metal bar. The metal bar has, and I have a list of number of stainless steel bar has number of metals in them that can cause allergies. For example, nickel, chromium, molybdenum, manganese, silicon. So they all can cause some sort of allergy. Because we don't want to place a bar in someone who has allergies to, for example, nickel. Then it becomes it becomes a whole host of issues having a bar that you're allergic to.
The issue is that with a allergy to stainless steel, we have to order a titanium bar, which are more expensive and require the custom bending. So it's not the default to get that bar, but the testing is pretty easy to do and much more accurate now. So it prevents the problems related to that bar allergy later on, which requires steroid treatment, sometimes antibiotics, sometimes bar removal.
Yeah. And then, Joyce, going back to the CAT scan, sometimes parents hear this term Haller index, which is basically a number that we look at to determine whether there's how severe pectus is. And there's also correction index, where in some places who are not used to getting a CAT scans with the correction index, the Haller index may be actually low.
The Haller index is based on a paper back in the late 80s where they measured the widest diameter of the chest and divided into that the narrowest diameter between the back of the sternum and the spine. And so that index, if it was above a 3.2, was considered severe and would benefit or qualify for surgery. And most insurance companies use that criteria. However, the Haller index can underestimate a severity of chest wall in kids who have really narrow chests and overestimate if they're really wide chests. So in 2012, another index was published that shows the degree you need to correct the sternum to make it flat. And a correction index is gauged by a percentage. So if you have a 10% indentation in your chest, that you'll look at that individual and say that's fairly normal. It won't strike you.
So anything over 10 qualifies for essentially a procedure.
So for example, you can have someone with a Haller index of 2.8, but the correction index 26%.
Right.
So if you look at that individual, that's a severe one. But if you only use the Haller index, then it's not going to qualify.
I also think that kids who have actually normal Haller index, those kids whose chest subjectively looks pretty severe, while they may have a normal Haller index, in my opinion, if they want to have the operation, they should have the operation. Because some kids are actually depressed. It psychologically causes significant pain. An agony. They don't like taking their T-shirts off when they go to swim, and a whole host of issues. And I do think that those kids will benefit significantly. But emotionally, they're just not doing well. So at times, insurances won't cover this procedure, and we have to call and argue with insurance and explain to them the situation with each patient. So while Haller index is sort of there for everyone to utilize, it's really not set in stone.
Right. And insurance companies are much better now about, you know, accepting the correction index. A child can come in and we use depending on the age of the child, they may be very ambivalent. They don't care if their chest is indented. Right. They're 12, 13 years old, 14. So those are children that we don't say you need surgery. You know, there's no urgency. And typically those kiddos will come back with their parents in a couple of years and they'll say, I don't like how my chest looks, or it will progress over that period of time. So that's why it's important not to get studies and tests if they're not thinking about potentially having the surgery, because it's the patient's choice eventually. And we don't try to talk people into having the surgery. It's a commitment, and it's the child actually has to have skin in the game and say, "Yeah, I want to do this." And
that's
parents
right.
have to, you know, be in on the decision as well.
All right, and then the operation itself takes about anywhere from an hour to 90 minutes.
That involves you know, measuring the chest and bending a bar, whether it be stainless steel that we bend ourselves or titanium that's bent by a company. This is the standard width and diameter of these bars. And you bend it to a convex position and then tunnel it behind the sternum from right to left. And then the anterior portion of the bar is going to be pushing the sternum out. And the bar will be behind the sternum like this. And then laterally, it's going to be outside the sternum, but along the chest wall underneath the muscles and skin. And you can put these strategically in a position where the defect is lowest by using thoracoscopy, which is a camera, and you have direct visualization of the chest. So the safety of that includes being able to see the heart, being able to see the lungs, and you tunnel the bar under direct vision so you can avoid all the vital structures and put it in the best possible position. Because sometimes behind the sternum, there are knobs of cartilage that if you blindly pass it through, the bar may be unstable and predisposed to subsequent bar turning and flipping. Okay. And the other thing that we've done in the past few years is in kids with very significant indentations, very low, where you can't see the heart fully behind the sternum, we do sternal elevation to elevate the chest during surgery to see safely to pass the bar. And in a lot of those individuals, probably 45-50% will get more than one bar.
The bar itself stays...
Yeah, depending on age, we recommend if kids are over 18 or up to age, we do up to age 29, 2 years at least. But in younger kids, we generally go towards 3 years because you want to maintain that correction through growth spurts and not take it out too early. And you also don't want to leave it in too long where you might impinge growth of the chest wall. And also the placement of the bars or the positioning of the bars is important to get an adequate correction. So the bar flipping occurs only about 1% of the time.
Correct.
And you'll lose your correction or it will look different. And that's the primary complaint of the child has.
Or severe pain while they were doing fine and now they have a severe pain. So those are the indications of something happened to the bar. So bar stays 2 to 3 years, and then we normally take it out as an outpatient procedure. The actual hospital course is anywhere from 2 to 4 days nowadays.
Yeah, we have a protocolized pain pathway such that our average length of stay, the kids go home on day 3. Whereas when we, several years ago, used epidurals, kids were here for 5 days. By their 1 to 2 week post-op checkup, most of the kids are just taking Tylenol and Motrin.
I think the lessons for parents to take home is it's a treatable disease. It's treated by operation. We normally get 3 tests, and these are CAT scans, allergy testing, as well as
echocardiogram.
The Haller Index 3.25 usually qualifies for your operation, but it's not set in stone. So if your child has a normal Haller Index or Haller Index that's below 3.25, you still qualify for the operation depending on your child's situation.
Correction index.
And correction index as well, as Dr. Kane mentioned. Both Dr. Kane and I do these operations here. If you have any questions and want to find out more information, please go to childrensnational.org. If you have further questions, please email us at info@surgucation.com. Thank you very much and have a great day. Thanks, Tim, for coming and joining us.
Thank you very much. Thank you.